Come on, get your Bibles out, get your tablets, your phones, whatever you're taking notes with. Get all that stuff ready. If you have the ability, would you stand to your feet? I'm going to get down on my knees. Let's go before the Lord in prayer today. Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're so grateful we can come into your house. We can lift our hearts and our hands, God, that we can experience and encounter your presence, God. We thank you, Lord, for what you've already done in this church service. And God, today we focus on you. We turn our eyes towards you, Lord. We don't look to a man or a woman. We don't look to the young or the old. We don't look to the black, the white, the brown, any other color we could imagine. We look to you. Holy Spirit, you are the true teacher of the church, so we welcome you this day. Be our teacher, be our guide. Give us your vision, your wisdom, your instruction, your direction, even the correction we need for our lives, Lord, and we'll give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it. God, we know you'll do your part. God, we commit to do our part. We'll give you our interest, our attention. God, we'll focus in, Lord, and apply ourselves to the Word of God. We know that you'll do your part, giving us eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts that have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the Word is sown. May it produce fruit in each and every one of our individual lives. Today, Lord, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches, both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. We ask that you would bless them as you would bless us, God. Bless our Baptist brothers and sisters, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals, God. We thank you for Calvary Chapel, Harvest, for Ecclesia, for The Way, for Trinity, Emmanuel Baptist, God, all the great churches that are out there, Lord. We would bless our assemblies and Four Square denomination, brothers and sisters, God, the Adventists and the Catholics, Lord, all those that are lifting up the name of Jesus, preaching your gospel truth, Lord. They're our brothers and sisters, and we don't think of ourselves as better than anybody else. But we see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom. So, Lord, we love you and we give you praise this day. In Jesus' mighty name, everybody in agreement said?
Amen.
Amen. Today, have a seat. Get your Bibles out. Go with me to the book of Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Once again, we are in Hebrews chapter number 12. Hebrews chapter 12. We're in a series called Running the Race. And as we go throughout today, I'll refresh your memory on where we've been. And if you haven't gotten all the other parts of the series, don't worry. You can catch up right where we're at. And today's message will stand on its own. Hebrews the 12th chapter, verse number 1 says this. It says, therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses. You remember part number 1 of running the race, that if we're going to run our race, we need to realize that there are those who have gone before us. That's what the Hebrews the 11th chapter is really all about, is all of the Old Testament saints, men and women who have gone before us, and who are now filling up the seats of a great stadium. And they're all the way up to the nosebleed section. And they're cheering us on and saying, you can do it. You can do it. You can run. We ran, and now you can run. Secondly, it goes on and it says this, and it says, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us. Remember, part number 2 and part number 3, we talked about things that could hold us back from running our race. Talked about things that maybe are okay and they might be permissible, but they're not profitable for our lives. We need to lay aside those things that even though they might be good, they may not be God, and they might not be what's going to help us to run. Also, we talked about sin, that as we turn our eyes away from our destination and we willfully rebel against what we know about God and the direction that God has called us to, that we now miss the mark and we get into sin. And in order to make it where God wants us to be, that as we see ourselves getting off track, that we need to repent, that is, turn from our way and go back God's way, and therefore we will no longer be missing the mark, but we will be headed towards the destination God has for us. Remember last time we were together, and it says, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, that we are to stay under the pressure, stay under the problem, stay under this trial, that God has given us ground, and that we're not backing off, we're not backing down, we're going to stay in there, and we are going to endure. Then today, verse number 2 says this, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Now I want to focus on those words, looking unto Jesus. Jesus is the author and the finisher of our faith. That means if we are to look to Jesus, that we need to understand that Jesus is our starting point. In other words, if we were in a race, we'd be at the starting blocks getting ready. And you don't go until you hear the sound of the gun go off. Jesus is the reason that we run. He is the one who had that gun in the air and who shot it and who started our race. And we are to look to him in order to find out how to start. You cannot run unless Jesus is your starting point. Because otherwise, the Bible says that you are dead in your transgressions and sin, and dead men can't run races. Come on, somebody. So in order to start, we have to look to Jesus. He's the reason that we run. He is our starting point. He is the author. He is the alpha. He is the beginning. He is the author. He's everything. He's the one who planned it all out. He's the eternal one. He is the start of everything. And therefore, if we're going to run our race, we have to start at Jesus. There's a story in the Old Testament that Jesus refers to in John, the third chapter, about the children of Israel being out there in the wilderness. As they're out there in the wilderness, fiery serpents start going through the camp and start biting people, and they start getting sick, and some of them died. And Moses is instructed by God, in order to stop this plague with the serpents, that he's to create an image of a bronze serpent or a brazen serpent, and he's to lift up it on a pole, and then anybody who looked up to that serpent on the pole now can be healed. And Jesus says, just as the children of Israel looked up to the brazen serpent, so also will the Son of Man be lifted up onto the cross. And he says, and whoever looks to me, he will be saved. See, we cannot start our walk, we cannot start our run, we cannot start our race unless we see Jesus high and lifted up, unless we see Jesus gone to the cross for our sins, unless we see Jesus as our Savior and our Lord. He is the start of our race, and he is the reason that we run. But do you know what else? He is also our reward. See, he's the author and he's the finisher of our faith. He is the one, he is the omega, he is the ending. He is the one who has finished it all. He's the captain of our salvation who completed the work and sat down at the right hand of God. And therefore, when we run, not only did we start at Jesus, but looking there at the finish line across the tape, as we run through and we cross that finish line, there's Jesus with arms open wide saying, well done, thou good and faithful servant. He is the reward of our run. Just like God told Abraham, I'm your son and your shield, your exceedingly great reward. He is our reward. The psalmist writes, whom have I in heaven besides you? And there's none on earth I desire but you. Jesus is the reason, and he's also the reward of our run. I'm going to put a statement up on the overheads. If you're taking notes, it might be good to write this down. We look to Jesus as our motivation, our strength, and our goal. See, sometimes as we look around in life and we start to see what's going on in the world, we start to get discouraged. We start to realize that things aren't going the way that we think that they should. Stuff's not happening. You know, the political sphere right now, there's a lot of turmoil, a lot of choices, and it doesn't look like there's any good choice out there, right? We're looking around going, what's going on? We don't really understand. We start to get discouraged. Start to look at the economy, and things should have been climbing up by now, but yet it seems like we haven't climbed out of this ditch yet. Things keep going down and keep going down, and prices are raising, but rates and rice, they're not going up. I'm not making as much money as things are costing. And we can get discouraged. We start to look at our children, and maybe they're not turning out the way that we were raising them. And we say, what's going on? We scratch our heads. Start to look at our communities. Used to be a great place to live, but now all of a sudden the neighborhood's gone south, and I don't understand what's going on. We get discouraged. And yet, external things will not motivate you. You need to get your eyes off of external things. See, if you want to have a motivation to run, look to Jesus. Jesus is the one who said, in the world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. See, when you look to Jesus, you realize, I can make it. God is good. When I look at Jesus, I see the goodness of God displayed on the cross. I see the goodness of God going and doing miracles, signs and wonders, healing the sick, raising up the broken, embracing the outcast. See, when I look at Jesus, I can be encouraged and I can have motivation to run my race. But you know what else? When I look to Jesus, I receive his strength. When I look to Jesus, I receive his strength, his grace, his sovereign divine ability on my behalf to get the job done when I can't do it. See, when I look to Jesus, it's almost like I'm a solar panel. See, I'm just staring at the sun. And as I stare at the sun, I receive that energy and that strength, and now I can distribute it in my life. See, where I could look to my own self and say, maybe I've got enough strength to face the day. But see, I don't have enough strength to face the day. I get discouraged. I get weary. I've only got so much resources. But when I look to Jesus, now all of a sudden I can receive the energy of the Son of God, and I can receive the strength that I need. When I look to my bank account, I say, do I have enough resource to do what I want to do, to go where I want to go, to be what I want to be? And you know what? In my own strength there, in my bank account, some of y'all said yesterday, I was sitting down as the first pastor. I know exactly what you're talking about. I had a stack of bills this high, and I had a stack of bills in the bank this high. You know what I'm saying? And it just is not going to work. Something's wrong there. See, when I look to that in the natural, I get discouraged. But when I look to Jesus, who provides all of my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus, see, now I get encouraged. If I look to my own ability, even for godly pursuits, if I wanted to be a witness, you know what? I cannot be a good witness on my own. You know, I'm not good enough, I'm not smart enough, I don't have a great enough story. There is no story greater than the story of Jesus. And listen, I'm not saving anybody. Jesus is the one who said, don't look to me, lift it. No, lift up Jesus, and now all of a sudden he will draw all men to himself. See, I can't do anything in my own strength. I've got to receive my strength from Jesus, and Jesus is my goal. Sometimes we look around and we have all these goals. I want to be famous. I want to be fortunate. I want to live a better life than my parents gave us growing up. I don't want to end up like my dad or my grandpa. I want to do something. I want to have purpose. But see, all those are admirable goals, I guess. But if that's as far as they go, that's where they're going to stop. See, Jesus is on ahead of us in eternity. And when you look to Jesus, you find the real goal. See, as you look to Jesus, Jesus will prosper your life and you will have a better life. As you look to Jesus, Jesus is the one who becomes famous. He must increase, I must decrease. Doesn't matter if my name's written on the earth. My name is written in heaven in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's the one that I want to be known by. As you look to Jesus and you realize that Jesus is your goal, on the road to Jesus, you will find everything else in life that you need. Prosperity and blessing and purpose and value. And for all that stuff comes with Jesus. As you look to Jesus, you will find your goal. Are you listening today? The Apostle Paul in the book of Philippians, the 3rd chapter, turn there with me, was writing about this very thing. Philippians chapter number 3. And the Apostle Paul often used illustrations of athletics. He liked talking about running. He liked talking about racing. He liked talking about wrestling. He talked about boxing at one point. I believe that if the Apostle Paul lived in Southern California, he probably would have been a Rams fan. Right? He would have jumped on the bandwagon with it. Oh, wait. Oh, no. Okay, we'll move on because now you all are saying, I'm thinking about finding another church pastor. No, I could care less. You think I watch football? I watched it the other day with some guys. We had fun. But I had more fun hanging out with the guys than I did watching the game, you know? So that's just me. I whatever. 49ers. The Raiders. You better be wearing black over there. Jesus. There it is. Team Jesus, right? Team Jesus. We'd have been on the Sheeps, not the Rams. All right, praise the Lord. Let's get back to the word, shall we? You guys are so naughty. You got me all off track. Philippians chapter 3, verse number 12. Not that I've already attained or I'm already perfected. See, aren't you glad that the Apostle Paul wrote that? Because we look at a guy like this, we say, this dude wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. This guy should be respected. This guy has got to be, the revelations that he had, he's probably the one who was talking about caught up in the third heaven. 14 years in the desert just getting revelations of Jesus and of God and getting the revelation of the dispensation of grace. I mean, this guy brought it. This guy was the great apostle. The signs of an apostle were done by him. Unusual miracles were done by Paul. They were just wiping hankies on his shoulder and taking them. People get healed. I mean, this guy had it going on. He was shipwrecked. He was snake-bit. He was put in prison and it still didn't stop him. This guy, there's Jesus right here, and the Apostle Paul's got to be right there, right? But what does he say? He says, not that I've already attained or I'm already perfected. He knew the flaws that he has. And you know, the Bible actually contains some of those things. This guy was rowdy. This guy, yeah, before Christ, he was killing people, dragging Christians out of their homes. He was consenting to other people's deaths, right? Stephen's death, you can see that. And so that was before Christ. But even after Christ, this guy still sometimes got a little burr up his saddle. I would imagine that there were people that said, man, don't you cross Paul. This guy's crazy, you know. He'll get in your face. Did you see what happened to Peter when he was sitting with the Jews rather than the Gentiles? Paul got in his face in front of everybody, man. I thought it was supposed to be confront in private and praise in public. Apostle Paul just walked over to him and confronted him to his face. This guy, at one point, the Bible records a argument that got so heated that him and his partner in ministry split up and they went different ways. You don't find them coming back together any later in the Bible. That's the type of guy he was. And he says, not that I've already attained or I'm already perfected. Thank God, because that shows me, listen, with all my failures, with all my flaws, thank God he's gracious. Thank God he can still take a rascal like me and he can do great and mighty things here on the earth. But this is what it says. But I press on, that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. In other words, I'm going to reach forward. I'm going to run my race. Why? Because God got a hold of my life. And I want to get a hold of what he has gotten a hold of me for. There is a purpose for my race. There's a course that God has set out before me. There's something that God wants to take me through, and therefore, I'm going to press. I'm going to run, and I'm going to go. Verse 13, brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press, there it is again, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Jesus is our motivation, he is our strength, and he is our goal. Jesus is the reason that we run, and as you look to him, you receive all those things. Now, in order to look unto Jesus, you're going to have to look away from everything else. In fact, the original language in the Greek talks about this concept that looking unto Jesus doesn't mean just focusing in that direction. No, it means I am looking away from everything else in order to focus on this one thing right here. Now, if I was to stare straight like this, you all understand that I have peripheral vision, that I can see up here, up on the roof, I can see people over here, I can see the carpet and everything down here, and I can see people over here and seats and all that kind of stuff, right? I got periphery, even though I'm looking this direction. And sometimes things on the periphery can get us distracted from what is important. In December the 29th, 1972, at 11:42 p.m., Eastern Airlines Flight 401 crashed into the Everglades. Now, upon investigation of the crash, they discovered that the flight crew had become preoccupied with a small burnt-out light that indicated that the landing gear was down. Now, I want you to hear me for a second. It's very important when flying a plane to know whether or not your landing gear is down before you try and land. Is that correct? Yes, it is. But they have a flight crew, and there were several members on that flight crew. And the pilot should have been focusing on flying the plane. But in the process, they started to check the little light. The light wasn't working, and so they pull the little light out, and they start trying to put a new light in, and they're getting so preoccupied, and after a while, they send a guy down to go and check. Well, maybe you can visually see if the landing gear is down, and so they're looking to see it, but they can't see, so they have to turn on outside lights. As they turn on outside lights, now all of a sudden the pilot can't see, and so they're trying to get the light to see if the landing gear is down, and they're still fiddling with this little light bulb, 35-cent light bulb, trying to get it in so that they can see whether or not the landing gear is down. And as they're doing that, the entire flight crew, including the pilot, got so preoccupied with this little light bulb that the plane just descended and descended and descended and descended until it crashed 18 miles from the runway, killing 101 of the 176 passengers on board. See, that little light bulb was important. Having the landing gear down is important. But where should they have been focusing? On flying the stinking plane. And in our lives, sometimes there are things that, yes, are important. Sometimes family things come up. Sometimes business things come up. Sometimes stuff in the community comes up. Stuff in the political realm comes up. Things on the earth come up that we see on the news, and they are important. Guys, listen to me. They are important. I'm not saying you to forget about your family, to forget about your responsibilities. I'm not saying you to stop paying bills. I'm not saying you to stop going to the doctor. I'm not saying for you to stop any of that kind of stuff. All that stuff is important, but the one thing that you should be doing is focusing on Jesus in the midst of all those things so that you don't crash land and miss the mark. You say, how do I do that? Here's how to do that. In your family, focus on Jesus in your family. What is our family all about? Our family is all about Jesus. We pray together. We read the Word of God together. We talk about God. We attend church together. See, our lives, our family focus, when we talk to our kids, it's not my ministry. This is not my church. This is our ministry. This is our church. This is our calling as a family, is to be godly people and to be a witness and a testimony and to lead others to Jesus. That's our family calling. How about business? Well, wait a second. Business is just so I can make the money so that we can eat, so that we can rest and get the strength, so that we can go make the money, so that we can eat, so that we can rest. See, we think of it as such a natural thing. No, all of my finances, all of my business, everything that I do is going to go into building the kingdom of God. That's what my life is all about. And Jesus is in the center of my business. And there are people in my job, my company, that need Jesus. So I'm going to be a witness on the job and my life. I will be the best worker for that job so that they can never say that Christians are lazy or that Christians aren't good workers. No, I'm going to be the best worker I can be to be a witness and a testimony of Jesus Christ. See, keep Jesus as the focus of what your life is all about. In the community, in the world, all that kind of stuff, indicator lights going off everywhere, and yet don't get focused on the periphery. Get focused on Jesus. Are you listening today? We have to look away from distractions. We have to look away from circumstances. And we have to look away from what others are doing. You know that others can be a distraction. Sometimes you can get so focused on other people. Well, what about him? Why are they getting blessed? God, I asked for that and they got it. What's up with that, right? Anybody ever felt that way other than Pastor Dan? Okay, the rest of you guys are liars. We'll cast the devil out of you guys later along with the lighting system up here that was going crazy. See, distraction, right? Here I'm trying to worship the Lord. What a beautiful name. And as I'm singing, what's happening? The lights are going like this. Indicator lights going off. No, we got to press through that. Got to press through that. And follow Jesus. Sometimes other people and the blessings that they have, or why are the wicked prospering? You can find all this stuff in your Bible. But it says, then I focused on the Lord. I went to the house of God and I got a vision of what God is doing. And all of a sudden, everything made sense. Matthew chapter 14, turn there with me. In the book of Matthew chapter number 14, Jesus has just had a great day of ministry. He fed 5,000 people with 5 loaves and 2 little fish. He'd been preaching the gospel, been declaring the kingdom of God. Miracles have been taking place. And he sends his disciples on ahead of him across the lake. Matthew chapter 14. And he goes up to pray, to connect with the Father. Middle of the night, he comes walking down on the water. He's about ready to pass by the disciples. They see him and they're like, oh my goodness, it's a ghost. And they start to freak out. And Jesus says, hey, whoa, don't be afraid. It's me, guys. Now Peter steps up. Matthew chapter 14. And it says this, verse 28. And Peter answered and said, Lord, if it's you, command me to come to you on the water. Verse 29. So he said, come. One word from Jesus. One word from Jesus. See, Peter had one focus. Command me to come to you on the water. She wasn't about walking on water. It was about going to Jesus. And Jesus says, come. And when Peter had come down out of the boat, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. Now listen, it was not the water that sustained Peter's feet. It was the word of the Lord. See, all you need is one word from God to step out on in faith. And that will hold you up in life. Are you listening today? Look at what it says. Talking to Peter. But when he saw, verse 30, when he saw that the wind was boisterous. Now stop right there for a second. Have you ever seen wind? Come on, answer the question. Have you ever seen wind? No. Have you seen the effects of the wind? Yes, you have. Have you ever felt the wind? For sure you have. So Peter saw the wind. Now, did Peter see the wind or did he see the effects of the wind? He saw the effects of it. Did he feel the wind? Yes, so he saw, he sensed, he perceived. There was stuff going on in his surroundings. There were circumstances that he saw that caused something to happen. In the same way, have you ever seen Jesus? Not unless you had a visit from him, right? But most of us have probably never seen physically Jesus, but have you seen the effect of Jesus? Oh, yeah. Man, people's lives are turned around. Things are going on. There's changes happening. Man, they used to be a drug addict. Now they're teaching someone about Jesus. They used to be, you know, totally off, angry. Now they're the most peaceful, wonderful person. Everybody wants to be around them. See, you can see the effects. Have you ever felt the effects on your own life? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Man, when I got saved, everything was different. It was like dark and dank and horrible the day before. Then I got Jesus. All of a sudden, the sun shone brighter. The birds were chirping. I felt like I was walking on air. I had purpose. I had a smile on my face. Everything was different. So we know the effect we felt on Jesus. So here's Peter. And it says, when he saw, verse 30, that the wind was boisterous, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, saying, Lord, save me. Now, I've heard a lot of preachers get down on Peter. He got his eyes off Jesus, started to sink. Shouldn't have done that, right? And I would agree with that. I would say, yeah, but listen, Peter did the right thing. Let me commend Peter for a second, because even though he started to fear, even though he started to sink, he got himself refocused on what was important. Lord, save me, right? He didn't say, wind, stop it. Or feet, don't go down. Or hopefully I can swim. No, he said, Lord, say, he cried out to Jesus. See, that should be the same response in our lives. As we're focused on Jesus and we have a word of God and we start to head in that direction, there may be circumstances surrounding us that we can see the effects of them and we can feel them on our own lives. And as we feel that sinking feeling, as we start to get afraid, we should cry out, Lord, save me. Now look at the next verse. Look at what happens. Jesus, Verse 31, and immediately Jesus stretched out his hand and caught him and said to him, oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? In other words, Peter, in that one little word, you had enough to walk on the water to me. And you shouldn't have doubted the word that you got. It would have sustained you and carried you. You already were walking. All you had to do was keep walking, right? Stay focused. Stay in faith. Believe the word. And yet you started to doubt, and therefore you started to sink. But Jesus caught him. Now look at the next verse. It says, verse 32, and when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. Now wait a second. Wait a second. When they got into the boat, the wind sank. Where was Jesus? He was out on the water. Peter says, command me to come to you. Where? On the water, right? Peter got out of the boat and walked away from the boat to Jesus. Where? On the water. And Peter started to sink. Where? In the water. Jesus caught him. Where? In the water. Now, Jesus and Peter are away from the boat. And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased. That means that Jesus, even though he caught Peter, did not take him out of the circumstances when he caught him. Come on, somebody. You're getting a hold of this. Jesus caught Peter and lifted him up and had to walk him through the circumstances to get into the boat. It wasn't until they got through the circumstances into the boat that the wind ceased. You say, preacher, come on, bring it home. Land that plane. Come on, somebody. What are we talking about here? Let me bring it home to you. In life, there's going to be things that you're believing God for. You're going to get a word from God that you can prosper. A word from God you can be healed. There's going to be a word from God that you can have a great family, that you can have a great life. And as you focus on Jesus and as you say, Lord, I heard your word, therefore I'm going to step out of the boat in faith, the word of God will lift you up and will sustain you. But there's going to be things that you feel personally and things that you see around you, indicator lights, things on the periphery that are going to try and get you off of the word of God, get you distracted from your focus on Jesus. And if you feel yourself sinking, it's time to get refocused, recalibrated, get back on track and cry out to the Lord, Lord, save me. I'm starting to sink. Jesus will get a hold of your life and he will hold your hand and walk you through the circumstances. He may not remove the circumstances. You know, if you're believing for healing, you might get sick. And Jesus may get a hold of your life and you may have to go through some things in that sickness before he removes those circumstances and you're healed. It's a process at times. There are those, remember, they shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Sometimes recovery takes time. Sometimes it's instantaneous, and we all love that. We all want to believe God for that, that Jesus will speak peace to the wind and the wind will cease. But there are other times that Jesus will get a hold of your life and you're going to have to walk through a process in order to get back into the boat before the circumstances are gone. God is telling you something. Some of you have had questions and you said, God, why didn't you answer my prayer? Oh, he answered your prayer. The moment you prayed it, he grabbed a hold of your life and he got a hold of you and he didn't remove the circumstances, but he is walking right there next to you, rocking right there with you through the water, through the wind, through the waves, through the circumstances, and there's going to come a day where you get in the boat and the wind will cease. Are you listening today? Come on, give the Lord a praise. Not only do we have to look away from everything else to look to Jesus? But listen to this. Looking to Jesus keeps us in line, and it fuels our faith. As we look to Jesus, it keeps us in line, and it fuels our faith. I got three kids. My youngest one's name is Titus. Titus is a cute little guy. Man, he's just so fun. He's the comedian of the family, and we have a lot of fun with this little guy. He's super smart. Learned how to ride a bike at age 5, and last year we went on a vacation. We went up to the mountains, and we were riding a bike on this trail. It's a beautiful trail. And I mean, it had big trees on both sides. It had a river flowing down one side. It had a highway on the other side. Just gorgeous. Mountain views, all that kind of stuff. And so this was really my little guy's first big ride, you know. We got two older kids, and they learned to ride real good. Myself and my wife, we both know how to ride. And so as we're riding bikes on this trail, you know, we were kind of concerned because this is really his first really big thing. We were going to go a couple miles. And so we knew he could ride and that sort of thing. But we would really see how he did on this trail. And as we're riding, my wife and I, we had one in front and one in back. We'd kind of switch off, but we would make sure that the one in front, you know, he could see where he was going and just follow the leader type of a thing. And then the one in back would make sure if he fell or if something happened or he needed to stop for a drink of water, that we could take care of him and signal the other group, you know, hey, hold on, wait for us, we'll catch up, or, you know, whatever, keep going, we'll catch up with you guys later, that sort of thing. But we always had that safety for us, you know. And so as we're riding and I was in the back, I noticed something about Titus. He's such a cute little guy, but I mean, just easily distracted. You know, six-year-old, you don't have much attention span at that time. And so as we're riding, you know, he's a little wobbly, but he's doing good, focusing on, you know, mommy and making sure to follow her. But then all of a sudden, he'd look over at the river. And all of a sudden, the bike is going this way. And I'd say, hey, come on, get back on track here. Watch where you're going. Oh, you know. And he'd come back, and then we're still riding. And all of a sudden, a big truck would go by, meh, you know, and all of a sudden, whoa, what was that? And we're over here. And hey! Stay on the path. Come on, you're going to hit one of these trees. We keep riding for a little while, and all of a sudden, there'd be a bird over here. And all of a sudden, we're riding over here again. And come on, stay focused. Where are we going? Look up ahead. Look where we're going. See, in our lives, if we stay focused on Jesus, it'll keep us on track. When we start to focus on, oh, what about this? All of a sudden, we're over here. Well, look at the flesh. Look at this. Look at what other people are doing. Look at what's going on over here. Oh, wouldn't it be nice? And all of a sudden, we're off track. See, if we can focus on Jesus, it'll keep us straight in line with him. As we focus, we don't have to worry about getting off track. No, I'll be headed towards Jesus. Speaking of Titus, there's a book in the Bible called Titus. Turn there with me. Right before Hebrews, you'll find Philemon. And before Philemon, you'll find Titus. After 1 and 2 Timothy, Titus. Titus was a young pastor that the Apostle Paul was writing to. He was on an island called Crete. You ever heard of somebody being called a Cretan? Right? That was kind of an insult. Well, there was a reason for that, and it's because the Cretans weren't really nice people. You know, they were kind of rude and crude, and maybe some of them would have lived in San Bernardino or the surrounding areas today. You know what I'm saying, all right? That is not an insult by any means. But they needed a pastor. They needed somebody to tell them about life, tell them about God. And here's this man, Titus, that had been sent there. And the Apostle Paul is giving him some instructions. Verse 11 in Titus chapter 2, it says this. It says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. Now, a lot has been said about grace in recent years. And we understand that. But what he's saying is the grace of God has appeared. The fact that Jesus went to the cross and now gives us the choice to choose where we go. Now, all of a sudden, if we will look to Jesus on the cross, the power of God will reach out and get a hold of us. And will save us and raise us up from the dead. That's the grace of God, and that happens through faith, we find in the book of Ephesians. But look at what it goes on to say. The grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. Verse 12, teaching us. So when we see the grace of God, it teaches us something. Teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lusts. In other words, grace is not an excuse to sin. Because I can mess up, I can do whatever I want to do, I can miss the mark, and the grace of God will still cover me. Now, while I understand the theology and I understand that, yes, all of our sin is covered by the blood of Jesus, and now we are removed from that, and now we have a new nature, and the grace of God empowers us to live a life, but it also teaches us how to deny and say no to the flesh, denying ungodliness and worldly lust. See, there's going to be things in our life, indicator lights that go out, things that happen that are going to try and get us off course. And the grace of God is what's going to teach us that as we start to look this way, we're going to say, no, I'm staying with Jesus. The grace of God is going to teach us that as we start to look over here and we see ourselves getting off track, no, Lord, save me, help me. And we start to focus back on Jesus. But look at what else it does. It says that teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, verse 12, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. Now, sometimes we complain about our environment. Well, why wouldn't I sin when all this stuff is going around, when there's all these billboards with all sorts of nudity, when there's all sorts of things, and people are gossiping, and they were talking about me, and how could I not talk about them when they were talking about me? You know, what goes around comes around. Yeah, I understand that, and there is a principle of sowing and reaping, but you don't have to be the one that they reap from. Hello? Just because they did something wrong doesn't allow us the opportunity to be something wrong. Just because someone else is ugly doesn't mean you have to jump in with them. And so it says, denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we should live soberly. In other words, we used to live punch drunk. We used to live inebriated with the world's foolishness. And now we don't have to live like that any longer. Now we can have right thinking. But it says, and righteously. Righteousness is not only a position, but it's also a practice. It's what we do. And the right wisdom of God for our lives is found here in the Word of God. And the grace of God teaches us about that. And then it says, and godly, that we would look like our Father in this present age. Wow. Verse 13, looking for, see, we're talking about looking unto Jesus, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. See, when you focus on Jesus, it will keep you in line. But not only that, it will fuel your race. There was a lady by the name of Florence Chadwick. She was the first woman to swim the English Channel in both directions. On the 4th of July, 1951, she attempted to swim from Catalina Island to the California coast. A dense fog lay over the entire area as she swam, making it impossible for her to see the land. After about 15 hours in the cold Pacific waters, she gave up. Later, she told a reporter, look, I'm not excusing myself, but if I could have seen land, I might have made it. She stopped within a half a mile of her destination. Now, not long afterwards, she attempted the feat again. Once more, a misty veil obscured the coastline, and she couldn't see the shore. But this time, she made it because she kept reminding herself that land was there. And with that confidence, she bravely swam on and not only achieved her goal, but she beat the men's record by 2 hours. Hello. See, for all of us, if we can remind ourselves that, yeah, there's going to be times that we don't see what Jesus is doing. There's going to be times that we don't really understand, God, where are you and what's going on? There's going to be things that we see that will be shouting at us that God is not good, and yet we have to remind ourselves, no, Jesus went to the cross. Jesus was healing. Jesus was doing good to all. Jesus embraced the sinner. Jesus corrected the saints when they got up. Jesus was good, and he's the image of God, and therefore I know that even though I can't see it right now, even though there might be a veil that's coming, even though there might be a mist that the world has put a dense fog, I know that my God is good, that he is real, that he is righteous, that he is favorable, that he is the blessed one, and that therefore I can make it to my goal because my eyes are fixed on Jesus. It fuels your race. It fuels your race. Last verse for today, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse number 18 in the New Living Translation says this. The Apostle Paul's writing is talking about the Old Covenant versus the New Covenant, how when the Old Covenant is read, there's a veil, there's a mist that goes over the heart. He said, but when we allow the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ to shine, it rends that veil, it rips it apart, and now all of a sudden we can glow with Jesus. And it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse number 18 in the New Living Translation, it says, so all of us who have received that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like him as we are changed into his glorious image. See, for all of us, we may not look that much like Jesus right now. But the more you stare at Jesus, the more you look at him, the more you look to him, the more you allow him to be your focus and look away from everything else and look just in focusing on Jesus, you will be changed into his image. Nothing could stop Jesus. Nothing could hold him back. Nothing could hold him down. He would not give up and he would not quit. And saints, if you will look to Jesus, then he will be not only the reason you run, but the reward of your run. Jesus will be your motivation. He will be your strength. He will be your goal. You can look away from all those periphery, all the other things, and you can look to Jesus, and it will keep you in line, and it will fuel your race. Did you guys get something from the word of the Lord today? Come on, let's give God a great big praise. Hallelujah. God is good. I'm going to ask everybody to remain seated during this time. Every head bowed, every eye closed at this time. Just want to take a moment of your time. Take about 5 to 10 minutes of your time. If you would just give me that. Everybody, please remain seated. Don't let anything distract you right now. I don't want you to focus on periphery. I want you to focus on Jesus. And I want to take a moment of your time and talk to you about your life. It'd be a tragedy if we came into the house of God and had such a good time singing before the Lord and listening to the Word of God. You guys were great today, by the way. Thank you. It's wonderful when people are getting a hold of the Word of God. And I know that you got something from God today. But it'd be a tragedy if we came in, had such a good time, sang and laughed, and some of us cried in the presence of God. It'd be a tragedy if we did all that, and your heart wasn't right with God, and you died, and you went to hell, and didn't make it to your reward in heaven. Sometimes people think that just because they come and sit in a church service, that that makes them a Christian. But you know that nowhere in the Bible says just sit in church and call yourself a Christian that makes you a Christian. It doesn't work like that. And yet a lot of people think, all I got to do is just go to church. No, that'd be like me saying, you know what, I want to be a fish. And so I go in the Pacific Ocean, I call myself a fish. You know what, that doesn't make me a fish. Eventually it'll make me a slimy, pruny human. but I will never become a fish. Can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. Sometimes people think that all roads lead to heaven. But do you think that God, after he sends Jesus, beaten, bloody mess, hung on the cross, buried and raised again to life, do you think after he does all that, he says, whatever you want to do, it's all good in the hood. Just do your thing, and I'll see you in heaven. No, he doesn't say that at all. Jesus came and he said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No man goes to the Father except by me. And the road to heaven is not expansive and wide. It's a narrow road, and there are few who find it. Today, I want to shine some light on that path because not all roads lead to heaven. You can't just do whatever you want to do and expect that you're going to make it. There's one way. Jesus said it like this. He said, you must be born again. Notice he didn't say be good. Sometimes we think if I could just be good enough. Listen, God's not looking for a good life. Your merit, that you can do enough good and God will let you into heaven. In fact, the Bible tells us all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You're not going to make it by being good. Sometimes people think be raised in church or because you're born in America, that America's a Christian nation, or whatever other nation you may have been born in that considers itself to be Christian. It doesn't work like that. Just because you're born in a region or in a community or in a family that calls themselves to be Christians, whether you go to church, raised in church, baptized or christened as a child, wear religious jewelry, a t-shirt that says Jesus, get a tattoo with a verse on it, it does not matter. That is not going to make it to heaven. You must be born again. Sometimes people think, well, you know what? My last church, I volunteered. I helped out. I sang in the choir, made decisions, knew a lot about God. I could quote scriptures. I taught in the Bible classes. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? But did you know that nowhere in the Bible say that God's looking for your volunteer sheet, looking for how many hours you volunteered in church? He's not looking for your membership card to a church. He's not looking for your good deeds like we talked about. And he's not looking for your mental ascent towards him. You know, demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. The devil himself knows who Jesus is and can quote scriptures out of his mouth, and yet that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So this is not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental ascent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, but this is about your heart. Jesus said you must be born again. You see, but Pastor, I've heard about that born again thing. It's weird. I seen it on a movie or television, books, Hollywood, internet, right? Read about it on a blog. Listen, let's not let Hollywood movies, television, books, and the internet define for us what being born again is. Let's let the Bible do that for us. You must be born again. What does that mean? It means that you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. The last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church today with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, listening to and focusing on the voice of God right now. God is speaking to you. Don't let anything distract you. Don't let anything on the periphery take you away from this thought. You must be born again. That means that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. If you haven't yet done that, then I love you enough to tell you the truth. You're not going to make it. But you don't have to stay in that position. Today, I want to give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to pray a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again right where you're at. And if you want to be included in that prayer, and it's this simple, I'm going to count to three in a moment. One, two, three, and pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. And I want to be included in that prayer today to invite Jesus into my heart. I'll see your hand go up. Maybe you can look up here and lock eyes with me. Just that way you know that I've seen you. And then after I've seen you and pointed and counted, then you can put your hand right back down. You say, Pastor, well, wait a second. If we lock eyes and all that, I might be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that. Because Jesus made this statement. If you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I will deny you. Today, it's your call. It's your choice. Sit there and do nothing when you know you need to get right. Or get your hand up in a safe and friendly place. No one's criticizing. No one's judging. No one's condemning. Most people are going to have their heads bowed and their eyes closed. It's just you and God right now. I'm just acknowledging, as a man who will see your hand go up, that you've made that confession of faith, that you're believing on Jesus for your salvation today, looking to him on that cross for the start of your race today. It's what this is all about. Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Today is your day. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before? Never given God all of your heart, never given God all of your life. I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand if you're lukewarm in this place? You know what that is? That's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again, and occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because the book of Revelation, Jesus said, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold. But if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. Only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. Today, your call. your choice. Right where you're at today, consider, where are you at with God? Would you make it? Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? If it's any other answer than I know that I know that I know that I know that I'd go to heaven, then today is your day. You can't think, hope, maybe your way to the kingdom of heaven. You got to know beyond a shadow of a doubt. Today, I'm giving you that opportunity. All across this auditorium, back in the fan rooms, wherever you're out watching by television in the foyer or the Love Rock Cafe, come on, put the burger down, get ready, get your hand up. And then you can tell an usher right afterwards or come into the church service. We'll pray together. You can be included in that prayer online, wherever you're at. I want to lead you in that prayer. If you need to do this, get ready to get your hand up. God sees, God's watching right where you're at as well. Here we go. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. There's one, two, three, four. God bless you. There's five, six, seven, eight. Got you over here. There's nine up on top. Got you. Thank you. Nine up on top. Who else today? There's nine wise people already. There's 10 over here. Got you. God bless you. There's 10 wise people. 11 over here. Thank you. Got you right there. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? Anybody else real quick? Thank you. Number 12. God bless you over there. Got you. Who else today? Need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. Thank you. I got you right there. Thank you. God bless you. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? There's a dozen wise people. Let's make it a baker's dozen. Number 13. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah. Yeah, you should. Let's go for God today. I didn't embarrass them, and I won't embarrass you. Anybody else? I think I got you already, but I'll count you again, number 13. There you go. Anybody else real quick? Come on. Need to give God all of your heart. Need to give God all of your life. Anybody else? Come on, just raise it up high for me right now if that's you. That's you. Where are you at, number 14, number 15? No, you need to get right with God. Come on. Anybody else real quick? Number, where are you at? Where are you at? Thank you. Got you right there. Number 14. Who else today? Over here? Man, give me a little wave if I don't see it. Thank you. Got you right there. Thanks for the wave. I appreciate that. Number 15. Number 16. All right, greedy little preacher. Come on, number 16. Come on, where you at? Anybody else real quick? Thank you, number 16. Number 17. Come on, don't be messing with God. Not time to mess with God. This is to look to God. He's good. He loves you. Number 17. Come on, quit messing around. Anybody else? Thank you, number 17. Number 18. Come on, let's go for God. Let's press today. Let's press. God wants to get a hold of your life. If that's you, just raise it up high for me right now. This is the last call. I'm going to do one last sweep, okay? And if that's you, I think I got you, my man. Hey, who else today? Who else today? Number 18, 19, 20. Anybody else real quick? Come on, let's go for God. And I'm going to wrap this up. Number 18 up top, got you over there. Thank you. Number 19 over there, got you. Okay? Come on, number 20. You were waiting for that big round number 20. Where are you at? You like round numbers? You got that OCD thing going on, right? You were waiting. I can't be numbers 19. I got to be number 20. Where you at? Anybody else real quick? If that's you, come on. Anybody else? I know there's 20. You're just waiting. Just waiting. Number 20. Got you. God bless you. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Give the Lord a great big praise. All right. Hallelujah. I'm going to lead you in that prayer to invite Jesus into your heart, okay? Now, I fished a little bit longer today, so we got to get you down there because it's time to dismiss. But I want to pray with you. I want to lead you in that prayer. So wherever you're at, across this sanctuary, if you're back in the family rooms, if you're out there in the foyer, time to come in. Let's pray together. Let's all stand. No one leave during this time. Very rude. We're trying to get people come this way. You're going that way. They're going to follow you that way. All right? Listen, that's not right. Let's respect the move of the Holy Spirit. And if you raise your hand, or you should have raised your hand. You come. Come on right now. Come on down. Come on down.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come. You can come too.
Look full in his wonderful face.
From the family rooms, if you or your children raise your hand, they're welcome at this time. Bring them down right now. Come on.
Will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
They're still coming. Come on, you can come too.
Oh, turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Come on, even if you didn't raise your hand, you come right now. Come on down.
Look full in his wonderful face.
Anybody else if you need to come?
And the things of earth will grow.
Come on, don't let up. Let's keep it going for them. Let's keep it going for them. They're still coming. They're still coming. They're still coming. Yeah, we'll wait for you. Come on down. Come on down. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation.
Of his glory and grace.
Hallelujah. They're still coming. They're still coming. This is your time. This is your moment.
Turn your eyes to Him. Oh, turn your eyes to Jesus.
All right. Hey, listen. I got to make a statement. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You look at this. This is pretty good. And I could pat myself on the back right now and say, look at what a good job I did. But that would not be a good pastor if I didn't leave the 99 for a moment, go after the one. So I love you guys. I'm so proud of you for coming forward today. It's the best decision of your life. But listen, there's still some people. You raised your hand, but you didn't come down. And maybe you didn't understand what was going on, but we're talking about salvation. We're talking about eternity. We're talking about giving God all of your heart and all of your life. And if you want to do that today, it doesn't happen just by doing this. It happens when you surrender your heart and life to Jesus. This is a safe and friendly church, and if you can't walk a safe and friendly church aisle for Jesus, you're not going to be able to live for Him outside of this place. So I'm going to have Reverend Elijah sing that chorus one more time. As he does, you know who you are. If you need to come, come. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Be bold. Jesus was bold for you, going to the cross, public, beaten, bloody mess, public spectacle for all to see, hung on the cross. Look to Him. Follow His footsteps. And get down here right now. Come on, let's welcome them. You come, let's sing.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face.
They're coming. Come on, if you need to come, just come on down right now.
The things of earth will grow strangely dim.
Anybody else?
In the light of His
They're still
glory
coming.
And grace.
They're still coming, yeah.
Oh, turn your eyes upon
Good choice,
Jesus.
they're still coming, come on.
Look full in His wonderful face, and the things
They're still coming, come on, you can come too.
Will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory.
Thank God you came. Thank God you came. I'm so happy for you guys. I'm going to lead you in that prayer just like I promised. I'm going to be born again. I don't know what God does inside of you, in your heart, to take that old man that was dead, that was lost, and make a new man, brand new on the inside. You're going to be born again right now. You get a new start with a brand new heart, okay? All the past mistakes, failures, sins, it's all gone from this point on. Okay? So we're going to pray together. I'm going to lead you in a simple prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. Now listen, this is not about the words of your mouth. This is about the expression of your heart right now. So if you fumble on a couple words, it's okay. All right? This is about your heart going before the Lord. Everybody's going to join in with us to encourage you during this time. Let's once again bow our heads. Let's close our eyes. And I want you to say these words out loud. Say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That He came, that He died, He was buried, and He's raised again to life just for me. I look to Him for my salvation. And Lord, I invite You to come into my heart, to be my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Wash me with Your blood. Cleanse me of my past and fill me with Your Holy Spirit. Let it be known that from this day on, I am a Christian. I'm born again. I'm headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. Thank You, Jesus. Amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today that He's worthy of. Hallelujah! Woo! All right. Now listen, we want to help you guys in your new walk with God, how to focus on Jesus, okay? We want to give you some free information, some free literature, easy reading, okay? That'll help you to find out what to do next in your walk with God, okay? And then also, we want to introduce you to someone we have here in the church who we call a spiritual personal trainer. You know, a physical trainer at the gym helps you get strong, right? Helps you focus in the right areas on your workout, that sort of thing. Spiritual personal trainer helps you to get your eyes on Jesus. Come alongside you for 5 weeks, teach you 5 things out of the Bible, very important in your new walk with God. It's easy, it's free, they'll describe how works, okay? And then they'll let you come right back out. Your friends and family will wait for you. Just make a left turn, follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give them a hand as they go. Come on, hallelujah.